The discount rate has a significant impact on the measurement of the lease liability for the lessees, and the net investment figure for the lessors. However, its determination is very challenging and requires significant judgment. IFRS 16 requires the lessee at the commencement date to measure the lease liability at the present value of the lease payments that are not paid on that date. These lease payments should be discounted using the interest rate implicit in the lease, if that rate can be readily determined. Otherwise, the lessee's incremental borrowing rate should be used. The interest rate implicit in the lease is the lessor's rate. The lessor is the party that calculates that rate based on factors like the credit standing of the lessee, the length of the lease, the nature and quality of the collateral provided by the lessee, the economic environment in which the lease transaction occurs. In addition to some data that are specific to the lessor, like for example, the lessor's estimate of the residual value of the underlying asset, and any initial direct costs paid by the lessor. A lessee can theoretically figure out the interest rate implicit in the lease, guided by the IFRS 16 definition for that rate. IFRS 16 stated that, the interest rate implicit in the lease is, the rate of interest that causes the present value of the lease payments and the unguaranteed residual value, to equal the sum of the fair value of the underlying asset, and any initial direct costs paid by the lessor. Let us assume that we have an asset with a fair value of 50,000. The lease payments are 7,500, payable annually at the beginning of each year for 8 years. The lessor's initial direct costs were 5,000. The unguaranteed residual value at the end of the lease term is 10,000. Let us figure out the interest rate implicit in the lease. These are the years in the lease term, from year 1 till the end of year 8 or the beginning of year 9. The fair value of the leased asset is 50,000 with a negative sign, and the initial direct costs negative 5,000. Think of it as if the lessor is making an investment in the lease transaction, and paid 55,000 as the initial investment. The lease payments are 7,500 with positive signs, as these represent the cash inflows for the lessor, payable by the lessee annually at the beginning of each year till the beginning of year 8. The unguaranteed residual value is 10,000 with a positive sign, which is the amount that the lessor expects to realize at the end of the lease term, at the end of year 8, or the beginning of year 9, if he sells the leased asset. And this is the net cash flows for the lease. By applying the formula of the internal rate of return in Excel, with 0 as a guess value, we get 6.33%, which is the interest rate implicit in the lease. This is the rate that causes the present value of the lease payments and the unguaranteed residual value, to equal the sum of the fair value of the underlying asset, and any initial direct costs paid by the lessor. You can verify that by computing the present value of the lease payments and the unguaranteed residual value using 6.33% as the discount rate, and you will get a present value of 55,000, which is equal to the sum of 50,000 the fair value of the asset, and the initial direct cost of 5,000. In reality, that calculation cannot be done by the lessee, as he does not have access to some of the key data needed for that calculation, like for example, the unguaranteed residual value, and the lessor's initial direct costs, and of course for commercial reasons, lessors would never disclose that rate, or the data used to build it, as that will reveal how much profit they are making from the lease transaction. For this reason, the standard requires the lessees to use the interest rate implicit in the lease, only if it is readily determinable. Otherwise, the lessee should calculate its incremental borrowing rate, to be able to measure his lease liability. But for the lessor, he is required to always use the interest rate implicit in the lease when calculating the net investment in the lease. The term readily determinable lends itself to some interpretations. Sometimes, Lessees hire a valuation expert to figure out the interest rate implicit in the lease, like in the real estate business. Some practitioners say that the interest rates implicit in the lease that are determined based on valuation experts are rates that are not readily determinable, as well as the rates that their determination involves significant estimates and assumptions. In this case, the lessee should be using its incremental borrowing rate. Now, let's look at the lessee's incremental borrowing rate. Again, figuring out the lessee's incremental borrowing rate involves a significant amount of judgment, which means that we are trying to figure out a rate that is reasonable rather than an exact rate. IFRS 16 gives you a broad guidance on how to figure the lessee's incremental borrowing rate. It defines the lessee's incremental borrowing rate as the rate of interest that a lessee would have to pay to borrow over a similar term and with a similar security, the funds necessary to obtain an asset of a similar value to the right-of-use asset in a similar economic environment. Let's stress some key words here in this definition. The interest rate that the lessee would have to pay. This reflects on the creditworthiness of the lessee. The higher the creditworthiness of the lessee, the lower the risk that the lessee defaults on lease payments, and therefore, the lower the interest rate that the lessee would be charged in the borrowing transaction. Over a similar term. This means that the interest rate should reflect the term of the lease arrangement. If the lease term is 5 years, then you cannot use the interest rate for a borrowing transaction that has a different term, say for example a term of 10 years. The interest rate used should be for a borrowing transaction that has the same term as the term of the leasing transaction. The reason is that the lessee's incremental borrowing rate varies as the length of the lease term changes. The longer the term of the lease, the higher the risks associated with the lease transaction, and therefore, the higher the lessee's incremental borrowing rate. With a similar security. To explain this, let us view the lease transaction as if the lessee has borrowed funds from the lessor, and that borrowing is secured by the leased asset. On the event the lessee defaults on the lease payments, the lessor has the right to repossess the leased asset from the lessee. That leased asset here can be viewed as the collateral for the lease transaction. So, when estimating the lessee's incremental borrowing rate, you should make sure that the interest rate used should be for a borrowing transaction that is secured by a collateral that is similar to the collateral in the lease transaction. You cannot use an interest rate for unsecured borrowing transactions. This collateral can be a building, a vehicle, or any other type of asset, and of course, the interest rate for the borrowing transaction would vary based on the form of the collateral involved. Of course, a high-quality collateral would reduce the lessee's incremental borrowing rate. A similar value to the right-of-use asset. This means that the interest rate that the lessee should pay for the borrowing transaction should be for purchasing an asset that has the same value of the right-of-use asset. Similar economic environment. This means that the interest rate should be for a borrowing transaction that is executed in the same country, same currency, and on the same date the lease transaction is executed. For example, the rate for a lease executed in the United States would differ from the rate for a lease executed in any other developing country. Also, the rate for a lease executed in Canadian dollars would differ from the rate for a lease executed in euros. So, from this discussion, it is clear that the lessee's incremental borrowing rate is not just the interest rate on a bank loan, or the weighted average cost of capital, unless these rates are adjusted to reflect these factors, to arrive at the lessee's incremental borrowing rate. Also, the lessee's incremental borrowing rate should be estimated for every individual lease transaction, as each lease agreement has its own terms and conditions. So, it is not a rate that is calculated once and for all. When should we estimate the lessee's incremental borrowing rate? The lessee's incremental borrowing rate should be estimated on the commencement date of the lease, the date on which the asset is made available for use by the lessee, and not the inception date, which is the date of signing the agreement, as the lease agreement might be signed before its commencement date with a considerable amount of time. There are some cases where the calculation of the lessee's incremental borrowing rate is not required. First, when the lease is either a short-term lease or a lease of low-value asset, and the lessee elects not to recognize a right-of-use asset and a lease liability for them. We will talk about short-term leases and leases of low-value assets at the end of this section. Second, when all lease payments are made on or prior to the commencement date of the lease. In this case, no lease liability calculation is required, because we have no lease payments paid after the commencement date. Third, when all the lease payments are variable payments that are based on sales or usage of the underlying asset, and not dependent on an index or a rate. Recall that, when the lease payments are variable payments that are based on the sales or the usage of the underlying asset, these payments are recognized directly in the statement of profit and loss. No lease liability calculation is required in this case. One last question in this lecture. Now that we calculated the lessee's incremental borrowing rate, do we need to revise that calculation? The lessee is required to revise the discount rate when there is a lease modification or a reassessment of the lease liability. We will talk about that in the lectures to come. This is the end of this lecture.